അഷദു അല്ലാ ഇലാഹ ഇല്ലല്ലാ വഅഷദു അന്ന മുഹമ്മദൻ അബ്ദുഹു വറസൂലോ. അഊദു ബില്ലാഹി മിനശ് ശൈത്വാനിർ റജീം. ബിസ്മില്ലാഹിർ റഹ്മാനിർ റഹീം. We were talking about chapter 4 verses 80 and 81 last time, which read, whoever obeys the messenger, he indeed obeys Allah, and whoever turns away, we have not sent thee as a keeper over them. And they say, obedience, but when they go out from thy presence, a party of them plan by night doing otherwise than what you say. And Allah writes down what they plan by night. So turn aside from them and trust in Allah. And Allah is sufficient as having charge of affairs. And last week, in relation to this, I also read out the commentary by Imam Ibn Kathir, which said that Muslims are required to obey the Holy Prophet and God. And of course, they are also required to obey their leaders. Now, the question that someone asked was, what happens if a leader asks you to do something which your conscience doesn't allow, or which you think is against the interpretation or teachings of Islam? Now, you see, all of these questions arise for two reasons. One, we pick out verses from the Holy Quran and we look at them, rather than considering the Holy Quran as a complete entity. And the second reason for such objections arising is this, that we lack history of early Islam, particularly the time of Hazrat Abu Bakr and Hazrat Umar and so on. Let me illustrate this by two examples. When the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, there were some tribes on the periphery of Saudi Arabia who rebelled. There were a number of things. There were a number of people who claimed prophethood, and there were some. Who stopped paying zakat. Now, interestingly, at that time, Hazrat Umar urged caution, and a majority of Muslims were with Hazrat Umar. They said, look, it's a very difficult and delicate time for the Muslim community. The Holy Prophet has just passed away, and in all religious and other matters, we depended upon the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his guidance and counsel and advice and so on. There are also, as you know, there were also differences between Ansar and Muhajireen, etc., etc. So let's be cautious. Let's not be heavy-handed with this. And someone of the station and status of Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu also counseled this. And as I said, this was the view that the majority put to the leader of the Ummah, now Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala. But what did he do? He turned to Hazrat Umar and he said, oh Umar, when you were ignorant, you were strict in the observance of law. And now that you have embraced Islam, you counsel me to compromise with those who are overthrowing a vital aspect of teaching of Islam, that is zakat. And he said, by God, if I am the only one who has to go out and fight these people, I will do so, and I will fight with them until every penny that they paid in zakat at the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that they pay that to the Muslim treasury. The point that I'm making is this, that you cannot, the Amir cannot, just because the majority, even if the majority says so, the head of a Muslim state cannot agree to something that is tantamount to overthrow of an Islamic principle or an Islamic tradition. And you know, this thing has been copied into everyday living by Western powers. What was the excuse that was used by the guards in gas chambers and death camps and so on and so forth? What was the argument that they used? They said, well, we were ordered by our officers, and we are in the military, and our training is that we obey our officers. And when they were tried at Nuremberg, this was rejected by the judges. They said, no, if an instruction given to you is unlawful, then you refuse to obey. You say, my conscience doesn't allow it. You say it's against the normal dictates of human rights and humanity that I should do so. I mean, I've used an extreme example here, obviously, but it applies. And now, when Western armies go to war, they have rules under which they have to fight. And these rules are actually to be found in the instructions that Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala gave to Muslim armies when they marched out, such as you not to harm innocent people, you not to harm old and the weak and the children, you not to destroy crops and cut down trees, etc., etc. Now, to the other example. That was at the time of Hazrat Umar himself. You may recall that Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala was a very strict person, and he implemented rules of Islam and Sharia very strictly. And one day, and he used to, you know, he used to take trouble to try and find out what the problems of the Muslim community were, and to see if they needed some kind of a solution or counsel. Now, he found that there was a problem in Medina, that there were lots of young men who could not marry. And he asked them the reason. In modern terminology, he carried out a survey. In those days, as there weren't any of these marketing or public relations companies, he just went around Medina asking people, why aren't you marrying, why aren't you marrying, why aren't you marrying? And the answer he got was, sir, we can't afford it. We take a proposal of marriage to a girl or her parents, and the reply we get is, the mehr is going to be so much, and this mehr has to be paid before the marriage is consummated or it's regarded as being valid. So what can we do? This is why we are unmarried. And Hazrat Umar, during the Jummah Khutbah, the following Jummah Khutbah, he stood up and he mentioned this problem, and he said, I decree that from today, women will not be allowed to ask unreasonable amounts in mehr. When he announced that, a lady stood up and she said, I'm not going to accept your ruling or your dictate. And Hazrat Umar said, why? And she said, because it's against the injunctions of the Holy Quran. The Quran says that if you give as mehr, if you give your wife a mountain of gold, you are not entitled to ask for it back after your married life has started. So God says, I can demand a mountain of gold, who are you to restrict it? This dictate, this instruction of you is unacceptable because it is against the law of the Quran. It is against the right given to me as a woman by Allah. What did Hazrat Umar do? Did he say, look, I'm the master of Saudi Arabia, I'm the master of Syria and Palestine and Jordan and Egypt and so on and so forth, so you have to obey me? No. He admired that lady. And he said, I'm pleased that women of Medina have a better understanding of the Holy Quran than Umar. What you have argued from this verse of the Holy Quran is correct. And I rescind my order that there is going to be a limit on the mehr that women demand to marry men. So this is not a sort of creation of a dictatorship where a man is or a group of men become leaders of a community or a Muslim state, and then they have carte blanche to say whatever they like, and the rest of the community has to follow that. I mean, I gave you other examples. For example, I said to you that a fundamental principle of the American Constitution is this, that the Declaration of Independence starts off by saying that, you know, here are some self-evident truths, and one of them is all men are equal. Now, the American government is not going to hold a referendum on whether this is true. They never have. Even when they had slavery, they never held a referendum on that article of Declaration of Independence. Even when during the Second World War, the American government rounded up every single Japanese living in the United States and incarcerated them you can only call them concentration camps. This article, the fundamental article, wasn't questioned or said, let's hold a referendum saying that the Japanese are enemies, so they're not to be regarded as equal to the Caucasians or Red Indians or Black Americans or whoever else. So all of these things you have to look at in the fundamental, in the light of the fundamentals that you believe in. You have freedom, but that freedom is limited. Every society does that. It limits your freedom to do things. Why? Because without it, what you will have would be chaos. If I were to insist that, well, you know, I don't care which side of the road the rest of the country drives on, I'm entitled to drive on the opposite side of the road, there will soon be a crash and people will be killed. And yet this country is called a free country. I'm not allowed to drink and drive or take drugs and drive. And yet this country is called called a free country. I'm not allowed to say I don't like paying income tax, so I won't pay income tax. And yet this country is called a free country. How many things should I count which are not allowed in the United Kingdom or United States? In the United Kingdom, I'm not allowed to go out and buy a machine gun and keep it at home. And yet it's a free country. The point is, your freedoms are in the context of having a law-abiding and a civil society. Civil means you have to respect the others' rights as well. And freedom does not mean anarchy. There is a great difference between the two things. So if you allow everyone to do what they want, you will have anarchy. In the same way, if you allow one person to dictate everything, you will still have anarchy of a different kind. But you will still have that. Now the interesting thing is, and I marvel at the you know, the approach of the Holy Quran. You read these verses, and although people read them in the context of 1500 years ago, when they were revealed to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but if you think about the society today, all of the verses of the Holy Quran are applicable to the society today. And they say obedience, but when they go out from thy presence, a party of them plan by night doing otherwise than what you say. And this is such a common occurrence that we see. We see it everywhere. That when, God, Allah, of course, is talking to the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But let's look at it in the context of an ordinary normal society. If we have a strong president, if we have a strong prime minister or someone, and they come up with some idiotic plan, what do we do? Do we stand up to them? Do we say, no, this is wrong? The ministers and their courtiers and their counselors and so on, do they stand up and say, no, this is wrong? They don't. Even in the West, they don't. You might have the odd example. We have many examples that I can cite to you now from the political history of United Kingdom. When Prime Minister Eden decided to invade the Suez, that was, we all know in retrospect, an extremely foolish thing to do. And as Egyptians said, it was done, Britain and France did it in collusion with the Israel. This is history. And the only person in the whole of the British Parliament who had courage enough to say, this is wrong, I will have no part of it, was a junior minister called Anthony Nutting. He had a promising career and he resigned. I remember when I was at university, there was, I don't know what it was, Arab Society or something, and they arranged a lecture by him, and he came and he spilled the beans about what really went on. But anyway, that is a side issue. My point was that in this country that's regarded as a free country, in this country where it is said that you should give your honest opinion to your boss. Even here, when the Prime Minister of the country had decided that he was going to embark upon a very foolish adventure, the whole of the cabinet, the whole of the parliament decided with him. And they said, your wishes are command. But what did they do when they left his presence? What did they do when they went back to their constituencies and spoke to the British people, who said, for God's sake, we've just come through a long war. We have rationing. Don't have food to feed ourselves. And you've embarked upon another adventure. Did these members of parliament say to their constituents that we didn't try and stop the Prime Minister? Did they say that we supported him and so on? They told them a different story. The result was that when this adventure proved to be a debacle, Eden lost his job as the Prime Minister. But look at human psychology. These powerful people, these influential people, what were they doing? They were playing both sides. You're the Prime Minister, they were saying, good on you. Yes, you have to establish Britain's might. We are an empire. How dare this upstart in Egypt say that he is nationalizing Suez? But to their own people, to their own constituents, when they realized that the ordinary man was against it, they were telling them a different story. They weren't telling them that we didn't try and stop the Prime Minister. because the Prime Minister might take away their officials' car, official cars and their grace and favor apartments and so on and so forth. And what I'm saying to you is this, that we read these verses and these things to think that they just apply in a religious context. But all of these things apply in a much wider context. This is why it is said that Islam has a solution to humanity's problems in all spheres of life, whether it's politics, whether it's economics, whether it's military, whatever it is. But we need to open our eyes and not keep thinking that this verse of the Holy Quran was revealed 1500 years ago and its application is only at that time. And there is another very fundamental thing that we must remember. It is only those nations, it's only those communities, it's only those families at the lowest level who agree on certain fundamental principles, and rather than debate and argue them, then move ahead on the basis of those fundamental principles that make progress in this world. One example of that, of course, is our own homeland, Pakistan. Fundamental principle, Pakistan was created. Some people say, well, it was created to implement Sharia. Some people say, well, all we said was Pakistan ka matlab kya hai, la ilaha illallah. What does Pakistan mean? All it means is unity of Godhead. It didn't go any further than that. Some people say Qari Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah said that the Islamic concept of justice will be implemented in Pakistan, so that means we must have Sharia. Other people say when he made his first speech to the Constituent Assembly, what he said was that a time will come when in this land a Muslim won't be a Muslim, a Hindu won't be a Hindu, a Sikh won't be a Sikh, not because they'll leave their religions, but because they'll be equal citizens of a state, and their religion will play no part on how the state treats them or looks at them. This means that Mr. Jinnah wanted a secular Pakistan. I'm not saying which side is wrong and which side is right. That is not my purpose here. But my purpose is to illustrate to you that the people are not united on a basic fundamental. And there are endless debates. I mean, if you read the columns of Urdu newspapers, particularly the editorial pages and etc., each side would be wasting its strength finding things from speeches of Qari Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah to support their point of view. He wanted Sharia in Pakistan. No, he didn't. He wanted secular laws which were just. Yes, he might have wanted Sharia, but he didn't want government interfering in the lives of the religious lives of the people and so on. Rather than moving forward and making progress, the whole country is constantly and continually engaged in these discussions and these debates. And that is a fact of life. And you can see that in any community. You know, however, sometimes I look at, for example, Mormons, which is an American sort of Christian sect. They say that Jesus Christ went from Palestine to the United States and he left their teachings there. And their founder was, I think the person's name was Joseph or Josiah Smith or something like that. But anyway, the point is this, whatever the teaching, however you might disagree with it, however silly even you might think it is that Jesus Christ crossed all these oceans and seas to get to America, they are all agreed on this fundamental principle. They don't debate it, they don't argue about it. They simply go out to try and propagate that message. And you know, Mormonism is the fastest growing religion in the world. And it is incumbent, it is necessary, it is a duty of every Mormon when he comes of age to spend 2 years propagating his religion. And they are sent from the United States to England to other parts of the world, and for 2 years they live in relative poverty preaching their religion, and then it's after that that they are allowed to go back and complete their advanced education or get a job or whatever it is. And no one questions it. You know, the Mormons, they are not just sort of people who don't have knowledge and who don't have intellectual prowess. You have lots of them in very high positions. They're doctors, they're professors, they're chief executives of banks. And you don't get to those positions without hard work and without having some semblance of intellectual prowess and intelligence. But they're united on something, and they say, well, it might seem silly to you, but we are going to preach it and propagate it. And maybe we'll convince one person, maybe we'll convince 10 people, we don't know, but we'll keep on trying. And that can only happen if you are honest and upfront about the things that you believe. And you don't go back and you say one thing in front of people, and then when you go home and or go outside, you tell a totally different story. If you think you are right, what is stopping you from saying that? You don't have to scream and shout and so on. But you can say it. You can say, look, you know, I think this is the right thing to do. And it is only in that that there is progress for organizations. God says, I know. And in fact, it's very interesting what the words of the verse here. God says, I know what they do. I know in their secret meetings what they plan. And the advice that he gives is, so turn aside from them. Well, leave them alone. Let them plan. You put your trust in God. If you believe in God, put your trust in God. God will see that, well, the next part of the verse says this, and Allah is sufficient as having charge of affairs. So, as I always say to you, when you read the Holy Quran, when you read verses of the Holy Quran, there is a great emphasis in committing the Holy Quran to memory, and in its own way that is meritorious. That's a good thing. It's better to spend time committing the Holy Quran to memory rather than I don't know, watching television or whatever. But how much better it is to also understand what you're remembering and to try and see if this message is still valid and how it can be applied in our everyday lives. Rather than, you know, you can buy parrots and you can teach them something. My brother-in-law in Rawalpindi has a parrot. You open the door and it shouts, Assalamu alaikum. But do you think it understands what it's saying? It just knows that when that door is open, this is the noise people make. So, although it's a good deed that you have done, as far as benefiting you spiritually and morally, you're in no different a position than that parrot who doesn't understand the importance of the words that it has just cried out. And eventually, this is very good advice that I wish I remembered all the time. And Allah is sufficient as having charge of affairs. When things go wrong, when things happen, we become depressed. Why? Because we don't have this unquestioning belief in the existence of God. If we thought, well, whatever has happened, it's been decreed by Allah, I've done my best. As long as you do your best, and as long as you have acted morally and honorably, whatever it is, and that has befallen you, then all you can say is, well, in Allah, I trust. And you know that we did have people like this in our Jamaat who did exactly this thing. Maulana Nuruddin was one example. If you read the history of his life, written by Akbar Najib Abadi, I think is the gentleman's name. Maulana Sahib says that when I was young and foolish, on two occasions, I relied upon human beings. And on both occasions, they let me go. Since then, I decided I'll only trust in my God. And He has never let me down. And then he gives many, many examples of how at times of difficulty and so on and so forth, God almost as a miracle found a way out for him. Another example was the Imam of Ahmadiyya buildings in Lahore, Maulana Aziz Bakhshi. He had an unshakable faith in God. In 53, when there were riots against Ahmadis, he went out and he drew, and people asked him to pray to God. And having prayed, he went out and he drew with his staff a line around Ahmadiyya building, saying that the rioters will not cross this boundary. And people looked at the line and they laughed at him that this old man has drawn a line on the floor, on the ground, in dirt and dust. Does he think these rioters who've got guns and who've got knives and swords and staffs, this line on the ground is going to stop them? What is this old foolish old man talking about? And what happened? That night, Mashallah was declared and the army actually established its posts to protect their buildings along that line in dirt that Maulana Aziz Bakhsh had drawn. And as he had said, God had told him that the rioters will not cross this line. So if you want to be safe, cross it and come in and live within that. There are many examples, hundreds of examples from the lives of members of our own Jamaat, which is, it's not time to go into now. But I again repeat my message that during Ramadan we have been reading the Holy Quran, and there's great emphasis on reading the Holy Quran. And as I say, that is a good thing, there is nothing wrong with that. But in addition to simply reading it, perhaps even memorizing it, how much better it is to understand the message that the Holy Quran is conveying, and how much more useful it will be if that message was then reflected in our own societies, in our personal lives, in our communal lives, as we deal with each other. And as I always request you to do on a Friday, especially in your last sajda, pray for everyone who may be sick or who may have some other problem, and for each other and ourselves, that God may keep us all safe and not put upon us a burden that we cannot bear. I specifically ask you to pray for two people, as my friend Khalid Sardar Malik, he is having some problems. May God ease his burden. another friend of mine called Tariq, his mother is very ill and being treated by radiotherapy and chemotherapy and so on and so forth, so which in themselves are treatment is as painful as the illness in these cases. So God may give her speedy recovery. I will now ask Nasir Sahib to say the second khutbah and then lead us in prayer, and then we will have a short dars after that.